Who among us has run a marathon? Well, I tell you, entering into the mood of repentance is like running a marathon. Marathon might take us about 3 hours. The best runners are two and change. And the mood of repentance actually is an ordeal like that. It's an ordeal. The spiritual path is really an ordeal. And the mood of the world is to do external ordeals, right? But really, the best ordeal is to get into the mood of repentance. It's not something that you do in terms of an accomplishment. It's an ordeal. It's not like a 100-yard dash. Okay, a marathon is an ordeal. It's something you get through. Mood of repentance is something you get through. And it takes, you don't want to just spend 2 minutes, 3 minutes or something, 10 minutes. You want to get into it and you want to survive the heat. You want to survive the heat. It's a way of surviving the heat, the pressure of listening and considering and hearing and absorbing and being in the atmosphere of this type of ideas outside the box talk and language and concepts and pointers and questions and considerations that just kind of cook you. You know, you're just like, ah. Feel the pain, the stress, like running a marathon. Oh, I'm winded. I'm tired. My muscles are aching. I'm hungry. You know, it's an ordeal. It's an ordeal. And so, really, it's the best ordeal to enter into. And after one gets through it, one should feel like, wow, you know, that was quite something, and I managed to get through it. That's the attitude. So these videos are an ordeal for sure. Absolutely, they're an ordeal. This is not fun and games. This is hearing something that just seems to be a little too much. Difficult. Running uphill. Like running uphill. It's no fun, right? But when you finally reach the top of the hill, it's like, ah, wow. There's the view. You know, there's the view. So, one has to have this sort of courageous determination to do it. Get into it. Work into it. It's not a quick thing. I put something on a shelf and I tidy up the room. Now I'm done. Now there's no sense of being done, really. It's more like you survive it. It's more like going into uncharted territory. And then afterwards realizing, ah, I survived it. It's the modern adventure. It's really the highest form of adventure. It really is. That's why I have forsaken all of the forms of adventure. I come from a very adventurous family, actually, in history and ancestry. But I decided, you know, to forsake all those types of external adventures, really, and go on this internal adventure, which is again way more adventurous. So just like in a marathon, don't be in a hurry. Set a pace. Set a pace. You get running, you set your pace, and you're off and running, and you're not trying to go too fast, you're not trying to go too slow. You just say, let me see if I can hold this pace. And of course, as you go along, there will be ups and downs, etc. But you expect that. You just try to be determined. The overall goal, you know, hold this pace for as long as I can. That type of thing. Cover as much territory as possible. Okay, so we're in the times right now. And Comet Ison is about what is this, 8 days away from going around the sun. Pretty much the 21st, it'll be like a 10 degrees on the horizon just before sunrise. And then it's going to dip below the horizon pretty quickly after that. Won't be able to see it. And then it goes around the sun, and then what? We are in amazing times, actually. The times that have been foretold. So let's not lose sight of that. These are amazing times, and we owe it to ourselves to do the best we can at right now. Absolutely, even if we don't feel like it. So the mood of repentance is a very interesting way of putting it. You basically are hearing stuff that maybe you don't want to hear. You're getting concepts, you're getting ideas, and your expectations aren't being met, your questions aren't being answered. The way things are going, it seems like, I'm a little off balance. All this stuff causes you to not feel like all breezy and like everything's great. No, it's like, wow, this is tough. But getting through the toughness and the ordeal of it all, you find yourself strengthened, and you say, that's not so difficult. I'm reading the Long Chenpa's book by Keith Dauman, and just a little bit here and there, and when I feel like it, and not really reading it, but just noticing it. And I seem to be able to relate to it. Now, part of the ordeal of mood of repentance is sometimes the speech will just drop off. See, you just drop off. But getting used to this ordeal is, I think, is the most incredible straight, direct path, actually. I don't see how there's any really substitute for it. Not everybody can appreciate the apex yoga, the radical Dzogchen, the Christ clarity, Not everybody can appreciate it, and so that's okay. But if you feel that you want to go through the ordeal, maybe you can. If you put yourself through the mood of repentance, eventually you will be able to appreciate it. And we can say stuff that just gives us a little whoa, like that, like for instance, today driving, and I was working on it, and I said that, Ramana Maharshi says find the I thought, the origin of the I thought, and then it immediately occurred to me, there is no I thought. How can we find the origin of the I thought? There is no I thought. There is none. And it's like, what? No I thought. Imagine if there was no I thought. Then what good would all the other thoughts be? What would they be in relation to thoughts if there was no I thought? So one thing we can do is just to appreciate, hey, no I thought, there is no I thought. And that one really hit me hard. And the all of this hits you at a level of appreciation that is beyond thought. Beyond thoughts. So there's something beyond thoughts that is appreciating these efforts and relating to them. What if there were no thoughts at all? What, no thoughts? Would there still be, would that be, mean there's nothing? Or would there still be awareness that we had no thoughts? Now, what you can do is just say, well, it's not this, not this, not this, not this, not this, not this, and that's one way to exercise or to really be strained, feel it. It's not this, it's not this, it's not this, it's not this, neither this nor that, nor that, nor that, not even that. And what this does is get you off of thoughts. Get off of thoughts. Because it's basically saying, it's not this thought, it's not that thought, it's not this thought, it's not that thought. It's not even the thought of not this thought. And you just keep doing that. Now, what really struck even stronger today was I was singing a little song from the 60s. I believe I'm falling in love. Maybe that's the 70s, actually. It's too late, babe, to turn back now. I believe I'm falling in love. And then I sang it the other way. I said, I believe I'm falling out of love. I said, I don't want to fall in love. So what do? I fall out of love. And then suddenly something arose in my mind and says, no. Let love fall into itself. Let love fall into itself. And suddenly, it was like kaboom. I stopped everything, like stopped, my mind stopped. I just said, like, what? It's like, oh, I think I just stumbled upon something here. And then the idea said, let everything just fall into itself. Let all thoughts just fall into themselves. We don't have to fall away from them. We don't have to fall out of love. Just let, you know, let love fall into itself. And right away, I felt I had touched upon some profound realization. And then I entered into the mood of repentance. It's a mood that comes upon you when you realize that you just have seen something incredibly profound and important. Let all thoughts fall into themselves. Don't try and fall away from anything. We don't need to try and fall away from anything. Let everything fall into itself this instant. This idea of falling into itself actually came from Longchenpa. And it's just like such amazing thing. Try this just to, you know. We don't have to understand what it means exactly, but there's an appreciation of that, right? There's some sort of inner appreciation, like, hey, that's a whole nother way of looking at the world, isn't it? If we somehow can something be seen as falling into itself? And could this be a perpetual thing and a refreshment? It's always falling into itself and emerging out of itself and falling back into itself. Something, there's something here about that falling into itself. Let's say someone seduces you into a love relationship, and you say, it's too late, you can't turn back now, you know, the romance is going, it's too late. And then you realize, oh my gosh, this has just been a crazy romance, and I'm wasting my life, I want to fall out of love. But how do I do that? You're thinking, oh my gosh, how do I fall out of love? You know, everything seems very difficult, right? Like, wow. And then say, no, just let love fall into itself. This seems to relate to an entire different perspective, doesn't it? It's like I've stumbled onto this entirely different perspective. And again, when that happens, don't pursue it. You know, it's just like you've opened a door into a new something, new universe or something, and it's just like, you just kind of say, wow, what did I just do? What just happened? We don't have to prevent anything. Just let everything fall into itself. Let the whole world fall into itself. Let the whole universe fall into itself. Let all perception just fall into itself. This would be a different perception, wouldn't it? Than what we have now. Let the song just fall into itself. Don't try to stop the song. Let it just collapse into itself, fall into itself. This viewpoint seems to have this enormous impact. There's different reactions, like, oh, what have I just done? I've just discovered some sort of key, you know, some kind of cosmic key or something. What do I do with it? Well, test again that the mood of repentance is what saves you. Don't do anything with it. There's no hurry to do anything with it. But I got the feeling that coming up, something is going to happen, absolutely. Which is what we need. Now, I don't know if you've seen Comet Ison's picture yet. I put a link to it on the last video, Practicing the Way of Jesus' Last Supper, or something like that. Maybe I'll put another link. You know, it's just like, wow. The picture's just like, wow. And more importantly is the fact that crop circles have been predicting this comet and depicting it in years past, from what, 208, 209, 210. There's no question about it. There's no question about it. The swallow-like appearance with the long streaming tail and everything that's just going on. Is no question that crop circles have been depicting this comet and its orbit around the sun, and the whole thing about this comet is almost like with what is going on with these crop circles? Who's, you know, why are they appearing before cosmic events? It's just, it's incredible. A crop circle appeared like the day before a supernova suddenly appeared in the sky, and it actually depicted the appearance of the supernova. It seems like these crop circles are like depicting events before they take place. So this Ison comet has been foretold, actually. I wonder if Christ was a comet, and the return of Christ is a comet. What are comets, actually? It's interesting, the star of Bethlehem, you know. So the star of Bethlehem a comet, a really bright comet? They follow the, you know, that, I don't know. But people are giving theories about comets, and it's very interesting what their theories are. But we know throughout history that comets have been something that people felt were cosmic triggers. And this Ison comet is showing signs of being an amazing cosmic trigger. It is taking on, I showed it to someone, someone said, it looks like the Virgin Mary, you know, the blue gown. And I pointed this out earlier, that I think the statue of Our Lady of Fatima in Portugal, I said, when I first saw Comet Ison and a picture of it and the statue, I said, my God, it's the same. Statue is depicting the way the comet looked at that time, very much so. And the winged disc, I mean, everything is going on with this comet. They're showing the it's putting out geometric frequencies and stuff. This is big time, what's happening. Really big time. And the world is not going to be the same. The world is not going to be the same. November 28th is a huge day. Thanksgiving Day. And I think a lot of the strain we're feeling is because of this. It is somehow the old ways are going to pass away. Whether maybe Ison opens up a wormhole or opens up a dimensional portal or something. Because the scoffers and belligerents are getting really severe now. I think in a way they're saying, no, we won't go, you know, to you. It's incredible how you know, rabid they are about, you know, denying certain stuff. They're kind of saying, they're trying to keep themselves, you know, maybe they're tempted. No, I won't go. No, I won't go. No, I'm going to, you know, remain imprisoned in a box or something. I'm going to remain loyal to death, they're saying. No, I'm going to remain loyal, no matter what. So, you know, they're having a hard time. Maybe Ison is a cosmic key. Now, I've been told it's going to go into four pieces, but, you know, whether that happens or not, I don't know. Is it the herald of the fourth dimension? Because we're certainly, this is the time when the Earth enters into the fourth dimension. There are four comets coming in, four horsemen of the apocalypse. And that we'll find out really, really shortly, actually. So it's very important to be timely right now, meaning on time, relevant to the times, and with a spiritual solution in hand, actually. You wanted to have it right with you, right now. And so I think this falling, let all things fall into themselves, is an enormous realization. To just have that concept, that perspective with you, appreciation of that possibility. that we have the capacity to simply allow everything to fall into itself. Let death fall into itself. We don't have to conquer death. Let death fall into itself. We don't have to conquer this sickness. Let sickness fall into itself. Let age fall into itself. Let everything just fall into itself, and then see what is left. As Aisan goes towards falling into the sun, right? but maybe it won't fall into the sun. Maybe it's going to, you know, make it around the sun. It's not going to disintegrate. We don't know. But every day gets getting that much closer, and it keeps crossing all these points where other comets have fallen apart, have fragmented. So we're wondering, will it make it around the sun? And will it trigger a coronal mass ejection? Which certainly some believe that it will. And some believe it'll trigger the kill shot for this planet. Some say that this typhoon, Haiyan or Yolanda, is a foreshadowing of a coronal mass ejection, a kill shot, which devastates our infrastructure. I looked at the electrical towers, transmission lines in the Visayan region of the Philippines, and so many are knocked down, just twisted, wrecked. The whole infrastructure is wrecked. And I just said, my gosh, is this what's going to happen to the whole planet from a massive coronal mass ejection from the sun triggered by Aisan to bring into this age? Is this Aisan the apocalyptic comet that brings an end to this age by wrecking the infrastructure? I mean, the Philippines, you know, one day the people are, you know, thriving and going about their lives and everything's great. The next day, I can't hardly imagine it. Knowing I have friends and know so many people down there that they're happy, thriving, bustling, industrious, and everything is beautiful skies, and they're going about their lives, and everything's great, and relatively great. I mean, it's not easy, but they're pretty, people, the confident people there. And now, everything just completely shattered and gone, and just nothing, Water, electricity, transportation, lodging, food, health, everything just shattered like that. And so it shows you what an infrastructure, a kill shot can do to an infrastructure. Now, I was told back in the late 1990s that the sun is going to give off a coronal mass ejection that's the strongest one ever seen. And impact this planet, it'll be the strongest impact this planet has ever felt from a coronal mass ejection. And it will level the infrastructure as it fry the grid, fry the satellites, do a lot of stuff that just collapses, civilization somehow. That's what I was told back in 1990. Late 1990s, I was told from some cosmic source. I don't know exactly what it was. It was definitely there were intelligence that foresaw this and said this is what's going to happen. Now, they could have been just projecting their own hopes and expectations. That's possible, right? And I mean, there may be those who want that to happen so they can take over the planet. So they're actually hoping and projecting this hope out in their projections of what's going to happen, and therefore they see that this is going to happen. That's what they see. But maybe that's not going to happen. We don't know for sure. But there are definitely those who see it that way. And the crop circles seem to indicate that a coronal mass ejection, a dragonfly, something really powerful is going to come from the sun, based on Aisan going in towards the sun. barely, you know, a week or so away from finding out, actually. Ice on slingshots around the sun, if it does make it around the sun, and then starts coming, you know, going out away from the sun. And so we have this window here, like a, you know, next couple weeks, actually, we should find out something. Now, what happened in the Visayan region of the Philippines? Aid came from all over the globe. So many countries, so many companies, so many people, so many organizations, all came in there, flooded in from all over the globe saying, we're here to help. Here's some, you know, we're here to help you move forward from this. Well, what if the Earth does get a kill shot? Is it too much to think that there will be all sorts of organizations and aid groups from cosmic sources coming flooding into this planet to help us? Why should we think that that would be strange? I mean, we're doing a similar thing to the Philippines. Philippines and all these islands that, you know, out in the Pacific Ocean, and, you know, we have to fly, people have to fly in there from all over the world. And it's not easy, you know, to get to these places they're going to, and yet it happens. It happens. So we're able to fly, mobilize resources, people, ideas, help, all this stuff to that area. So if we're able to do that, then why do we think that there aren't other entities, intelligences in the cosmos that are able to do that for us? And if we're compassionate, why do we not see that others could be compassionate towards us, actually? Jesus says, when the catastrophe comes, lift up your heads, for that's when your salvation is near. So in other words, don't give up, don't freak out. Now, the crop circles seem to be showing wormholes in parallel universes and all this kind of stuff that indicate that there can be an emergence into this world, or this world can emerge into another dimension, that kind of thing can happen, absolutely can happen. Ison may be the catalyst for all this stuff to happen. Now, how did someone know how Ison would appear to us in the sky years before it came, and the crop circle appeared, you know, with incredible detail and similitude? So, you know, how is that possible? It must be some sort of, you know, time travel or something. So, this radical Dzogchen guru shows up about the November 4th, I guess, right? Something like that? I don't even quite remember now, to tell you the truth. But yeah, I think it was the 4th. Longchenpa, to me, in what's going on? You know, so something important is going on in the world. There's no question this teacher is like a super heavyweight of history. There's no question about it. So why would he show up at this time? Something's going on, right? So we're just absorbing this. We don't have to come and answer, what's going on, what's going on? No, something is going on. That we know, something is really afoot, you know, right now. And we've been pointing to this. We know it's coming. And just the way that Ison has been presenting now is just stupendous. This is just it's just incredible. People say, nah, just a dirty snowball. You know, just a dirty snowball. What? This is incredible. The symbology of it, historically, you realize that somehow historically there have been all sorts of depictions of something that looks similar to this, you know. I don't think we understand what comets and what's going on, really. I think there's more to it. Just like you pour a drop of resin, drop a catalyst in resin, drop it in, and the resin all changes from that one drop. It's like comets are like the drop of catalyst. You know, they're catalysts. So they're going to catalyze something. So we stay away from too many numbers and calculations and all that stuff, the activity of the mind, because the answer is not to be found there. But if we just stay on it, it's going to come, the answer is going to come. The picture is going to emerge, there's no question. Picture is going to emerge. We're very hot right now. You can feel it getting very close. So the discipline is like we're in a sweat lodge, you know, and it's just sweating. We feel the epiphany is about to arrive. And we just hang in there. They call Jesus the Savior, you know. What if the comet is the Savior in some way? Bringing salvation. A lot of abstract depictions of Jesus also look like this comet. It looks like a heavenly being, you know, divine being or an angel, really, doesn't it? Like an archangel. Now, how did the ancient people, you know, how were they able to see these things? That's the question. We don't understand, but they must have had some capacity. We don't understand. They must have been visionary. Had some way of, I guess the shamans. You know, the ancient times, they could travel, astral travel, and view things in space. Actually, of how they appeared, and somehow travel up with a subtle sensory body and view things. You know, closer up. Like our now telescopes, binoculars, you know, can do. They were able to see cosmic events and see what they look like. The heavenly messenger, they called angels heavenly messengers. Well, these comets are carrying some sort of message. Vibrational frequency, who knows how many levels of what kind of message are they carrying? Now, if we can adopt this, let everything just fall into itself, right where it is, right as it is. This is like a super medicine, actually. A super medicine. And maybe Long Jenpa is actually here out of compassion. He epitomized compassion as far as truly caring for spiritual welfare. This is something that seemed to just, you know, it was there. Maybe there's a sense that this is the time of suffering for the planet, and maybe this is drawing these type of, you know, resources forth, spiritual resource forth, and working to get us to, so we can heal, we can help. But how can we help, you know? I'm thinking, how can we help the Philippines? How can we help those people? We can't even get stuff to them, you know. Directly, we can donate money to these various things, and eventually, you know, maybe that'll help somebody have some sardines at some point and stuff like that, and a little bit of help. Yeah, absolutely. But you know, the misery. What about spiritually? You know, is there some sort of spiritual help that could be given? This is the question. So, could there be a torment coming up from the planet, actually? And if so, how could that be helped? Now, people say that Jesus healed everyone, just walked past him. People just saw him, you know, just thought of him, healed, you know, some healing, like, wow, afflictions dropped away. What is this capacity? Is it not this effortless allowance of all things to fall into themselves, to subside into themselves? Is this not like some kind of some ultimate healing realization? Longchenpa says, when everything is allowed to subside into itself, what happens is there's a radiant clarity emanates. A radiant clarity emanates. That's what is there then. When everything, all illusory appearances are allowed to fall into themselves. You're not trying to get rid of them, fighting, judging, manipulating, just allowing them to fall into themselves. This radiant clarity then emanates. That's his testimony. So, I wonder if there could be remote healing taking place, you know, some sort of remote healing that could be applied. Maybe we can apply it to the Philippines. I mean, I happen to be connected to the Philippines. I know the Philippine people, and very much so. And, you know, it's interesting that maybe this is something that could be done, some sort of remote healing. Because I've heard the screams of the, you know, they're in torment. And, you know, they're good people. They're just like anyone else around the world. Got their, you know, got their personalities, got their ways, you know, but they're people just like us. I can tell you that. I'm associated with many Filipinos. So quite a few from the Visayan region, actually. So, you know, they deserve healing just as much as anyone. Do they have their faults? Of course. Well, of course. I mean, the political structure there. So people hoard. Do they grab? Do they do things maybe they shouldn't? Yeah, of course. That human nature that is that way. But fact is that people are suffering. Just ordinary people are suffering, and just taking it, you know, just real bad. So I wonder if this is like a test case, as something to wake us up and say, hey, you know, maybe we need to actually be able to do remote healing. Can affliction fall into itself? Can deprivation fall into itself? Can sickness fall into itself? Can scarcity fall into itself? Can death fall into itself? Can illness, disease fall into itself? Why not? So I'm just wondering if you know, Longjinpa showing up, in, at least in my consciousness, and getting my attention, like knocking on my door, say, hey, it's time. Huh? What? Yeah. It's time that, you know, to help. Time to help to help. I said, what can I do? I can't, you know, what can I do? I can't even go anywhere. Why do we need to go anywhere to help? Can pain fall into itself? I remember Bulanath, the wife of the husband of Ananda my Ma, dying with smallpox, the painful kind, and he was just suffering horribly. And he finally acknowledged her, asked for her help in some way, and he was a very proud person. And he felt that his path was the best. And Anandamayi Ma was actually a transcendent spiritual figure, like Longjinpa. Perhaps even transcendent, even higher than that. So it's difficult to understand. But she just passed her hand over his body like this, you know, and pain was gone like that. He was in bliss. What did she do? Just let the pain fall into itself. Well, you know, don't have to do anything. Don't have to heal anything. Just let it fall into itself. Fall into its original nature, which is what pure spaciousness. Let all illusory appearances fall into their own nature. Fall. Just let them fall into themselves, and then you will find that. That there's just only bliss, radiant clarity. And she healed at distances too, could heal at distances. People would be sick and pray to her and be healed. Because the faith in the guru it enables this falling into itself to happen, and everything just, you know, falls away, falls into itself. Let fatigue fall into itself. So who's to say we cannot do remote healing, actually? Who's to say that these great gurus like Anandamayi Ma, Raman Maharshi, etc., were not actually doing an enormous amount of remote healing around the globe during the tumultuous 20th century? People are fighting and killing and so much strife, and perhaps their agony fell into itself through the grace of these, you know, great gurus, and through the grace of Jesus, the grace of Buddha, etc. That somehow they were able to release, you know, the agony. It fell into itself. Who knows what these great compassionate beings are doing for us. So this is I hadn't thought of this before. This just came up just right now, taping all this stuff. It's been possible. Absolutely it's possible. Because I'm thinking, what can I do? What can I do? What can I really do to help these people all really right now? And going forward, the people in Haiti, you know, everybody's got their area. They feel like maybe I should do something for these people. I felt bad that I didn't do anything for, you know, the Fukushima, the tsunami, because I have had friends there too, actually, very dear people. I love that area. And But I didn't feel called to that for some reason. I don't know. I don't know why, but I always felt like, uh-oh, you know, we need to really find some way to help one another on a profound scale. Okay, on a profound scale, something more profound than all these organizations. Something more profound than that. Because maybe there's going to be some catastrophe where people actually decide, you know what, I think I'll just shift dimensions right now and go to a better world, because this one is wrecked for now, you know. Let's give the world a rest, kind of thing. And then they say, well, let's let the world just fall into itself. Just let it be. Let it just fall into itself. Maybe this is the technique of wormholes, of shifting dimensions. Letting everything just fall into itself. Possible. Don't sell these gurus short, you know. I mean, there's some reason that they are with us, you know. There's some reason why that they're here subtly. And of course, it's the end of the old ways that are not as potent, not as powerful, not as helpful. Because people are going to look and find out what really works. And so we're on the edge of the dawn of a new age as far as what really works. I don't think people are going to put up anymore with what doesn't really work. Those who do are going to go to some other, you know, some, their ways are going to diverge. And we could be just a few days away from this. This is now right on our plate. So in silence, what do? We hold our attention. Keep our attention there. And then gather our resources. Can we go for it a little more to gather our resources here? This palm tree motif just came to me, like it just appeared in my life. I went up to the dump and it was just lying, sitting right there. I backed in, it was sitting right there. And then someone next to me had a tall truckload full of palm fronds, an entire truckload, and it's unloading all these palm fronds. Well, that's a very profound symbology, actually. I noticed that and I said, wow, something's really going on here. I had this backdrop of just like sitting, set right on a pile of garbage, just right there. I picked it up and looked at it. I said, oh my gosh, I can use this. So, and then the palm fronds symbolize what? Healing. I mean, palm trees to me are my favorite tree. My favorite natural thing is a palm tree, because it's so spacious, isn't it? It evokes the spaciousness to me. Symmetry, simplicity, spaciousness. It seems like you'd fold it back up into itself, right? It just has this amazing, powerful symbology for me, the palm tree. I think when Jesus rode into Jerusalem, didn't they strew his path on a donkey? Did they strew his path with palm fronds? And so here's this guy with a truckload full of palm fronds, hundreds and hundreds of them, and just right in front of me, just unloading all of them, you know. And I was just like watching that. And I was just saying, is this, wow. Maybe we'll set up a remote healing location or something. Maybe that's what, you know, could happen. So people who are able to do this will go to some place and they'll be able to, you know, work on remote healing. That's possible. Because there could be some really bad stuff coming in the world. Or we could try and remote heal it ahead of time, as it were. Remote in time as well. Not only remote in place, but remote in time. Could we allow the future to fall into itself? Is that possible? Can we allow time to fall into itself? To fall into itself? I mean, if people discover this is possible, that changes everything, doesn't it? That's a quantum transfiguration. You can't even fathom, we can't even fathom it, really. Which is a mood of repentance is important, because we're dealing here with something which is unfathomable. We're dealing with something here that's unfathomable, isn't it? Can space fall into itself? I don't mean pure intrinsic spaciousness, but space as we see it. Can that fall into itself? Space-time fall into itself? Right where it is, not needing to go anywhere or do anything. So the ability to at least consider these things is a really good ability to have. Very, very, very excellent. Just to hear it and say, maybe, you know. Because maybe we'll hear it again at some point. and we'll say, yeah, I've considered that. feel kind of comfortable around this kind of, you know, structure or lack of structure or way of possibilities. You know, I feel comfortable around that. So I really don't know what's going to emerge. It's like we're in this quantum time now, and it's getting hard to know what's going to emerge next. I mean, when you get a teacher like Lan Chenpa showing up, you don't know what's going to happen next, really. You read his stuff and you just say, oh my gosh. Unquestionably, someone who is really has allowed everything to fall into itself. There's no question about it. And what does that mean? I don't know. This is, you know, higher understanding, higher teaching for sure. And so, I can't really know what will emerge next. I can't really know that. Just like Ison suddenly brightened, you know, the last several days, since the 14th, I think, it's just like suddenly boosted, you know, its intensity, and it's suddenly taken on this incredible presence. Suddenly this presence is, wow, it's here. So presence is showing up in the world, suddenly it's just showing up and brightening. And these new concepts are emerging. And the mood of repentance is simply to be able to absorb this, right? So that's what these videos are helping with, is helping the viewer simply absorb all this. So that when the next thing happens, they can absorb that too. We can absorb the next thing. I feel confident. Whatever it is, I'll be able to absorb it. That's how I feel. Whatever it is. And that's what the mood of repentance does, because you know you can fall back on this mood of repentance. I've just... sort of free appreciation, just this appreciation, this undefined appreciation, undefined patience, undefined composure, just being steady and being with the unsteadiness, being steady with the unsteadiness. Getting your sea legs, just, you know, allowing yourself to adjust, readjust to the new paradigms that are emerging now. You know, remote healing, allowing space and time to fall into itself, wormhole, dimensional shift, whatever. It just goes on and on and on and on and on. Really, you don't even know what's possible next, but just adjusting to it. Saying, okay, this is where we are now. This is where we are now. And get a sense of the future. This is what we're moving towards. So, okay, we'll just stay where we are now. Get adjusted to it. And then we'll let tomorrow take care of itself. And, you know, whatever arises tomorrow, we'll be right with it. But meanwhile, we'll just stay right where we are. And don't get into trying to figure it out, like remote healing. Well, how are we going to do it in details? No, forget about the details. Forget about the details. Because something else is going to emerge. Something else is going to happen, which is going to, you know, change the equation from where we see it right now. That is for sure. And we'll burn ourselves out if we try to figure it out ahead of time. It emerges holistically, it emerges in context, somehow it comes about in the right way that we could never get it by struggling right now with it. So don't even struggle with it. I'm going to go back in and watch the end of a basketball game or something, you know, just Just let it be. We did our work. We ran a marathon, maybe a half marathon here tonight. But, you know, we got into some incredible territory just like that. So just let it be. Continue on with the stability of your life. Chop wood, carry water. And tomorrow is, you know, certain that something will. Maybe something will fall into itself tomorrow. Maybe things will start falling into themselves tomorrow. Maybe we're all comets falling into our inner sun, you know, the inner sun of radiant clarity. Clear, pure, radiant clarity. All right, so, very great. And just keep this poise, just keep the poise. Don't let the mind go running all over the place. Forget it. Just keep the mind on a tight leash. Don't try to figure anything out. Just let something emerge. It will emerge, an idea will emerge. And you'll suddenly say, hey, you know, wow, what an idea. Where'd that come from? It just, you know, it was ready. Bubbles are coming up, and it reaches the bubble, reaches the surface. And you know, wow, like that. So, who knows what the next bit of information is going to be. It's amazing times right now. All right, very great. See you soon.